All right, so let's do a roundup of what happened in the budget in terms of announcements for a taxpayer, and especially for a new tax regime taxpayer. And also, when we talk about having LTCG and STCG rate increase, what are the implications for an SIP investor? There has been indexation benefit taken off from the real estate. So how is that going to impact you as a property buyer? And also, what kind of implications are we looking at investing in debt mutual funds? Let's call upon Arav Pandya, founder Money Edu School, for this particular discussion. And Arnab, good evening and welcome to the show. So a lot of details that we knew about when the budget was announced, it was mentioned in the speech, but a lot of it has come in the finance bill. So let's just focus on that first, because otherwise everything is almost highlighted everywhere in terms of the new revision in the tax slabs, NPS and standard deduction especially. Let's start with real estate. This looks like a dampener, although we've seen a reduction in the tax rate, but the indexation benefit has gone. How would you like to decipher this for the property buyer's point of view?
Good evening, Pavita. So if you look at the overall capital gain structure, the long-term capital gain structure has been simplified with a single rate in force. So any asset that you have, if there is a long-term capital gain, you will have to pay tax at 12.5%. Now, within this, everything is included. The only question then remains is that when do you consider an asset to be a long-term capital gain? For that also, there are two buckets which have been created. Equity, direct equity, equity-oriented fund, business units, they become long-term after a period of 1 year, while all the other assets become long-term after a period of 2 years. So if you look at real estate, after a holding period of 2 years, this asset becomes a long-term asset. Any gain which you have would then be taxed at 12.5%. Now, if you compare this to what was the situation earlier, there was a rate of 20% which was applicable, but there was a benefit of indexation. Now, indexation is nothing but the increase in the cost of an asset, in this case, real estate, which is increased proportionately every year based on the inflation that is there in the economy. So the CBDT gives out an inflation index number each year. And based on when you bought the property, you can raise your cost accordingly by the specific inflation figure. So that inflation benefit, which is also known as indexation, that goes away. So the way this new system works is that you have to just compare your cost price with the sale price, and the difference there so would be the amount that would be taxed at 12.5%. So you do not have to change the cost as you had to do in indexation. The gross amount of the difference between the sale price and the cost price becomes the taxable amount on which 12.5% has to be calculated. Either you pay it or you try and save tax by reinvesting it in properties or bonds or whatever mode you want to adopt. So this in simple ways is the new change which has occurred. The rate has gone down, but indexation has gone off the table. So each property holder will have to calculate the exact situation that they will face to find out whether under the new system, what is the impact that they will face.
When we're talking about property, we're also talking about the inheritance property. So is this applicable even on those kind of real estate or properties that we have? Any kind of changes in those taxation terms?
No, this is applicable for all properties. The rules with respect to inherited property remains the same, which is that in case of an inherited property, the holding period of the new holder has to count the holding period of the previous holder also, and the cost of the previous holder becomes the cost of the new holder. Now, there is one point which needs to be clarified, which is that what happens to properties which were bought before the 1st April 2001, because a 1st April 2001 is when the new series of indexation came into being. So according to the clarification which has been issued, you can take the fair market value of the property as on 1st April 2001, if it was bought before that, for the purpose of your cost while calculating your capital gains in this regard.
All right. Let's also look at, so this was real estate, and although this really requires a deeper discussion, but then we really have to move on and talk about the changing definition of debt funds and the kind of relief that we are looking at that the debt mutual funds are getting. How would you like to explain this? Even though we saw the indexation benefit going away from the debt mutual funds, but now they are also coming in the ambit of short-term capital gains. So how will this impact, and how should we look at it and understand it?
So, to understand what has actually happened, we need to take a step back and go back just before a year, when the new norms for debt mutual funds came into being. What was done was that a new category called specified mutual funds was created under Section 50AA in the Income Tax Act. Under that act, any fund which fulfills that condition of a specified mutual fund would not have any long-term capital gains, even if it was held for a very long period of time. So, for example, if you hold a debt fund which qualifies under this rule for a period of, say, even 6 years, then whatever gains that happen would still qualify as a short-term capital gain for the investor. Now, the earlier definition of which funds qualified under this said that any fund where the equity component was not more than 35%, that would qualify as a fund for this purpose. Now, the problem with this was that obviously all debt funds fell into this category, but along with it, gold funds, silver funds, international funds, fund of funds, because all these funds did not have more than 35% of their portfolio into domestic equity. So all these funds also got classified under the taxation for debt funds. And due to this, there was a higher levy which was put on these funds. Now the budget has changed the definition of a debt fund to say that a debt fund would, or rather a fund which is a specified fund under this section, would be any fund which has at least 65% holding into debt and money market instruments. Now, a debt fund to qualify for this kind of taxation would have to have at least a minimum of 65% in debt instruments. So obviously, all the debt funds qualify. But the real benefit is for the other funds, which is that the gold funds, the silver funds, the international funds, the fund of funds, which do not have more than 65% in debt. All these funds would not be eligible for the debt mode of taxation. And that is good for the investor because they can ensure that if you hold these other funds for a period of more than 24 months, then those would qualify as a long-term capital gain, and the long-term capital gains rate is 12.5%. If the debt fund taxation was to apply, then what would happen is that no matter what the time period of holding, the entire gain would be classified as short-term capital gain, and short-term capital gain would then have to be added to the income of the individual and taxed at the applicable tax slab. So the taxation could very well go up to 30% plus. So that is avoided for all these other categories of funds. So now you have a very simplified or a very clear structure as far as mutual funds are concerned. One, if the holding period, or rather if the portfolio consists of 65% or more into equities, all those are equity funds where the equity mode of taxation is applicable. If the holding is 65% or more in debt and money market instruments, then the debt taxation comes into play. And if it doesn't fall into either of these, then you need to ensure that the mode of taxation whereby 24 months is the holding period for classification of long-term capital gains along with a 12.5% rate, that becomes applicable.
Now, but then looking from a taxation perspective, you know, we always compare debt mutual funds and with other fixed income instruments, which also includes fixed deposit. Does this change make it more attractive as compared to fixed deposit, or all these are at par? How will you like to explain this?
No, so in effect, what was happening over the last 1 year for debt funds, the same tax impact remains. There is no impact, change of impact on debt funds. But if you want to compare it with a fixed deposit, what happens is that in a fixed deposit, the entire interest is taxable as income from other sources. Similarly, even for a debt fund, all the income which arises would be taxable as short-term capital gains, which is the same impact as adding it to the income. But the question now is that which of these options can actually give you a higher yield over a period of time? In that sense, there is a difference between these two instruments, even though the mode of taxation is similar. Because what happens is that if you go for a fixed deposit, your rate is fixed for the time period of the deposit, irrespective of what happens. When you go for a debt fund, there is an added element of the debt fund actually getting some capital gains or loss also, because of the fact that if, for example, you are in a declining rate environment, then you will find that the returns from debt funds are more than average. Similarly, in a rising rate environment, the return from debt funds dips below their normal average. So that factor has to be taken into consideration, and which is where the debt fund can actually score over a fixed deposit if you have selected the right kind of debt fund, because there are 16 types of debt funds in the market. So based on the market condition, you can select a specific kind of debt fund which can suit your portfolio and your requirements. And that is where there is a scope for a higher earning for the investor, which then even with the same amount of taxation could end up giving you a higher yield than a fixed deposit.
Small question, and then we'll wrap up this segment. I think we have our other guest, Anil Rego, who's also connected. But then now, since this entire thing excludes gold funds and international funds and funds of funds, so these categories attract the similar kind of taxation which was there before the budget. Is that right?
So, no. So, before the budget, actually, first of all, this change which has occurred in the definition of a specified mutual fund is applicable from 1st April 2025. So for this year, all these funds, gold funds, international funds, fund of funds, they still will be subject to the debt mode of taxation. So at the moment, the taxation remains the same. The change will occur from 1st April 2025 when they will move away from the debt mode of taxation and towards the middle ground, which is that 24 months for a long term and then 12.5% applicable rate without indexation.
All right, I think that will be all. Thank you so much, Anna, for being on the show and helping our viewers understand this very complicated taxation changes as far as debt mutual funds are concerned. Thank you.
If you like this video, then like, share and subscribe to ET Now.